Hello and welcome to the Knit Girls. This is episode 273. I'm Laura, also known as Lala.
And I'm Leslie, also known as You Don't Call Me Les. It is Monday, November the 2nd.
I can't believe it's November already.
I know. My older sister is going to be 39 this year, so she's going to have a mental breakdown about July of next year. So, anyway, it's been a busy week. We've got lots to talk about. Laura even went to a cool new event she's going to talk about in,
yeah.
Well, new to her.
It's new to me. It's not, it's like 25 years old.
Yeah. And we'll talk about that in favorite things. We usually talk about what we're working on first. So works
like
in progress. Up to you.
I can go first. So I am working on right now a pair of toe-up socks out of lollipop yarns on the Beefcake base. They are Halloween socks. But I did not finish them, so this is the second one.
I'm going to have the knitting police come to your house.
I'm still going to wear them. It was fun, though, because I was knitting them on them at a UT volleyball game, which is University of Tennessee, and their colors are orange and white, so I felt like I was spirited.
It's here's that orange you can't sit with. There's a terrible video. I'm going to have to link that now. Okay. It's about this guy who really hates UT orange. But it's just so funny. I don't even care about football, but I watch it all the time because it's funny. I'll put a link to in show notes.
Yeah, definitely. This is the first one. So they do not have heels, and I was going to do a forethought heel, but I was at a work function where I had plenty of time to knit, so I did not get my heel placement, and I just kept knitting and knitting and knitting. So this is the first one, and this is the second one. And I'm thinking that they are not the same. Yeah, they are not. They are better, though. So I had gotten to around this point on the second one and realized I had four extra stitches. So I ripped all the way out. That's fine. And it was almost your thing all over again. But now this one's...
You mean my socks that are still at your house that haven't...
Yeah, I have to find them. I have no idea where they
are. They were on the bookshelf.
Yeah, that stuff got... away and moved. So it is right to that point, but the stripes are off a little bit, which is not going to bother me, but I do need to remember. It's because I had that wee bit of black up there, because this happens to me every single time, by the way. I start binding off
in one color,
and then I run out and I bind off with the next color. Every single pair of socks I own, this is, you would think I would learn, but I don't.
I say that's just a conscious decision on your part.
Yeah, always. So this is the first sock, and this is the second. It's like a DK weight, so I get to use 1.5s, which is super. What's that, 2.?
Oh my god, on a DK weight?
Yeah.
That hurts my heart, man.
I'm actually, next time I buy sock needles, I think I'm going to go to 00s.
Like, it would be bulletproof if I knit it in that gauge, or that needle and yarn
it's
size.
Totally not bulletproof. I bet you might be able to see through it. No, it's a decent fabric. So ridiculous, my loose knitting. So, I actually got to pull out my old 1.5 knit picks, which made me super happy. So this is the first and second sock. I have this much left of the ball of yarn. And then I have a contrast for the heels. So that'll be fun. And that is living in my Amy Beth sloth bag, which has birds on the inside. Birds on the inside. So that is the first thing that I've been working on, and that got worked on a little bit in class and at work when I was at a meeting all day. The second thing that got worked on is Grace. So I'm scooching back a little bit. Can you see? So this is Grace. That's the back. That mesh panel's in the back. And then the front is just like that. The blue yarn is holding the stitches.
For the sleeves.
Armhole stitches. So it's a little bit big right now. We're going to see how it goes. But we will see. And it's a little bit shorter than I like my sweaters typically, but I did follow the pattern length, so we will see.
The upside is that she has a fatter, shorter friend that it could possibly fit.
That is a horrible way of describing yourself.
Fat is just a word, dude. It doesn't have any power. Sorry, I'm going to get on my feminist soapbox, and that's not what this podcast is.
Rant at me later. So that is all that I have worked on. I have a million things that I want to work on, but I need to get through these two. I'm trying to, like, I want to cast on all the shawls. Like, there's so many shawls, and there's so many baby stuff. Like, I need to knit a very, very late baby present for someone, and then start some other baby presents, and then just want to knit all the things. So I need to get working on all these things so I can knit all those things. The sweater, since I've already started talking about, I think I said it was Grace by Jane Richmond's, mm-hmm. but I'm going to say it again. It is out of Plucky Feet in the Barn Door colorway. It is being knit on size 2.5, which is 3 millimeter needles. So that's super fun. It is taking me around 2 to 3 hours to knit an inch. So also fun. But it's going pretty, you know, for all that being said, it's going pretty well. And I did get it done at 11:59 Saturday night, so I could count it. And that was East Coast time, so I still had time to post for the Harry Potter House Cup.
Oh, the body.
For my owl.
Okay, yeah.
Which is, yes. So the Harry Potter House Cup is a made-up, like, Ravelry game, and you get points based on things that you participate in. And an owl is a large project that spans 3 months, and so you are supposed to hit 50% by the end of the second month, and you set your own 50% within reason. So my 50% was the body of the sweater being done, and then my other 50% will be the two sleeves, the button band, and sewing on of the buttons. And I do still need to get buttons. I had ordered some from China that came today. I bought them off of Etsy, but they are heavier than I was anticipating. And since it is such a lightweight sweater, I don't want to add, like, if I add heavy buttons mm-hmm. to it, it'll just... So
you need, like, a lightweight acrylic or a light wood...
Yeah, or clay, maybe.
Clay might be too. I guess it depends on how heavy or how thick the button is, but.
Yeah. A lot of the female clay ones are pretty light, but yeah, I need to figure that out. I'll probably make a Joanne's run. I don't know. I'm thinking silver buttons. We'll see. So, but that probably will all be too heavy for what I need.
It depends. If you get small ones, they may not be.
Yeah.
Like a hammer tin roof, you know, like TIN. Some thin tin ones, they might work okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, that is the plan for the race. So it's your turn.
Okay. I've been knitting a fair amount this week. I'm on call again. Super fun. I'm one of those suckers, basically, who, whenever somebody says, you know, I've had something come up, I need to trade on call, can anybody trade with me, I'm usually the person that trades, because it doesn't bother me too much, because I can sit and knit at home or read. So when you're on call, at least with my company, you need to be at home or within home 10 minutes or so of home the entire time you're on call, which is around a week, or close to an internet source where you can remote in. And it doesn't bug me too much to do it, because I can knit or read or whatever at home. But this is my last one for the year, because I've traded so much. Hopefully nobody else will suffer.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So I've been doing a lot of knitting. So the first thing that I've been knitting on are my socks for... I'm using the wrong one of these. The Margaret, the lady that I... send all of my quilts out to for long-arm quilting. I trade her a long-arm quilt for a pair of socks. So I finished number one.
On the long-arm quilt, yeah. The quilting on the long-arm machine.
Because, yeah, typically for the quilts that I do, it would cost somewhere between $100 and $200 to have quilts long-arm quilted. So we both sort of figured with the labor and the materials, it sort of evens out. So that's what we do. So I finished sock number one, which was pretty easy. I just had to do another inch and then the toe. And then I started sock number two.
Oh, you've gotten pretty far.
Yeah, I started this last night, and I've
Oh,
been
wow.
doing this at, well, I was on a call for 3 hours last night, so I got some stuff done. So I've got another repeat to go, and then I'll start on the heel. So hopefully I'll have turned the heel next week.
I bet you will.
And then, and that's out of Apothecary Yarns. They are still in business. I went and double checked. And this is off the deep end in the merino cashmere nylon blend.
Cool.
And the other thing I'm working on is in, well, that's in my Jessalu Firefly bag. And this is in my Knitspin Farm, just a bag she made for me. I don't know if she ever sold this patchwork style. She might have.
Some new bags go up this week, I think.
I am knitting. So the lovely folks over at Knit Spot, Laura over at Knit Spot sent us some yarn very recently, within the past couple of weeks. And I've been dying to try it out because this yarn is, I would say it's as close as you're going to get to hand spun in a commercially
Commercial.
available yarn.
So KnitSpot does breed specific yarns, which is very, very cool. It is the brainchild of Ann Hansen, who does KnitSpot designs. A lot of the yarn is used in her designs now, so there's a lot of pattern support for the yarn. And it's just really, really interesting blends of stuff. And she's out of Ohio, and she does a lot of local Ohio festivals or pop-up shops type
So
things.
I've got the Bare Naked Wool is the name of the company. This is Better Breakfast Fingering, and it's a merino nylon dehaired alpaca blend. Never tried anything like this. And it's in the muesli colorway. And it was even squishing it in the skein, I knew how I was going to enjoy knitting with it. So I actually hand wound it into a on my
Oh,
on a
pretty.
Nostepinne. I hand wound it because it was so nice to
Next
work
time
with.
you hand wind something on a Nostepinne, you should have Michael take a video of you because one of our questions is how to use a Nostepinne.
Oh, well, it's pretty
And I
easy.
don't Nostepinne.
You can use anything as a Nostepinne. I've used a spatula as a Nostepinne
I
in a
know you
pinch.
have. You're like a Nostepinne genius.
I'm a Nostepinne ninja. Totally gonna be the
That
title.
is awesome.
So I like the way that it looks when you
Yeah.
wind it that way, and it's nice and squishy. Anyway, so I am knitting the pattern that came with it because it seemed like a really nice pairing. This is the Wheaton cap. There's also a mitt pattern, but it's got a couple of different cables in the pattern, and I really thought that would. I wanted to see how that came out
I'm
in.
glad you're knitting that because I'm not a cable person, so I was gonna choose a different pattern.
Well,
So I'm
I
glad you're
wanted to
doing that
see
pattern that came
how
with
the
it.
cables turned out in a yarn like this, which it doesn't have a super high twist to show off that definition. So I wanted to see how it would look. I'm only into the ribbing.
It's pretty though.
Oh, I thought I just found an error, or like I messed something up, but I didn't. It definitely has that sort of handmade feel to it. It's got imperfections in it, and I say that not in a negative way. You can tell that this is something that is really done with care. You know, it's not all perfectly uniform. There are
Yeah,
sections that are
that's
slightly
awesome.
thicker or slightly thinner, but it's so squishable. I really like working with this yarn.
So that yarn comes in what, 400
This
and
is 450 yards. It's 4 ounces, and the gauge is 6 to 8 inches, 6 to 8 stitches an inch. And there is a disclaimer on the
nothing
yarn.
crazy.
Due to the artisanal character of our yarn, there may be slight variations in shading from skein to skein. So because like this isn't necessarily, I don't know that this is dyed or whether it's just spun based on the color,
Yeah.
because they're
Bare
all
naked,
natural
I think, is
colors.
not, yeah, I
I
don't think
think you're
they're
right.
dyed.
Duh. Bare naked, not dyed. You are correct.
Well, I don't know about that, but that would be my interpretation of that. So,
So that's the other thing that I'm actively working on. I really am enjoying it. I just finished the ribbing and I have to switch to go up to the next needle size. As always, Anne's patterns are incredibly well written. The
Oh, she does
charts are
great job in there.
top-notch. So I'm not having any issues whatsoever with the pattern. But I will tell you guys more as I work more with the yarn and see how it comes out in the cable. I'm interested to see that.
Cool. Do you have any finished objects?
I do.
Really?
I have
Cool.
stuff, dude. I got
You
stuff done this
do.
week.
Oh, you totally do. I got like I have finished and then I have the way we do show notes is usually it's like my works in progress, Leslie's work in progress. My finished objects, Leslie's finished objects. But my spinning somehow is in the middle there. So I was like,
Oh, probably because I just
but I
cut
can
and
never.
pasted without paying attention. That's the way it usually
Oh, you're
happens.
fine. Would you like me to show my awesome finished object
Sure,
or do
go
you want
ahead,
to
because
start?
it's taking me a
Awesome.
second to get stuff back together.
So my whole finished object is this little acorn ornament. It is wee. It is I don't even know who the pattern's by. Hold on. It was knit on size 2 needles. And I did link the pattern in the text. Well, I linked my project page. It is the Acorn Ornament by Elizabeth Murray. I think it was a $2 download. On Ravelry. Yep, $1.99. So it uses worsted. She calls for a size 4, but I went down to 2s because I'm a loose knitter and I don't like my fiber fill showing through. So it is wee. It took me like an hour to knit it. And it's
Is
very
it for
fun.
you or is it for someone else?
It is for, I don't know. It's not very good, so it might be for me. It's not bad, but I think I could do better next time.
It's handmade, dude.
I know. So maybe. It was I needed something last minute for Quidditch in Harry Potter House Cup, and it was like a happy memory. So I talked about going for walks with Alice and she stuffs her pockets full of acorns. So which is a true story. That child will put lots of stuff in her pockets. So, which I think all kids, it's
Oh
very
yeah.
like a Calvin and Hobbes type childhood. Like the walking through the woods, filling pockets full of acorns, which if she was Calvin and Hobbes, they would then use them to throw at Susie. But,
How do you know that she doesn't use them to throw at her sister?
she could. It could happen. So that is my one and only, this little itty bitty like 10-yard acorn is my one and only finished object, and it used scraps of Noro and scraps from the hat that I made for Genevieve for the Knit More Girls. I made Genevieve a little hat, so that's leftover scraps from that. I was just trying to pull out worsted that looked okay together. So that is my only finished project object for this week.
I have several weeks that go by that I don't finish anything, so.
It was a cute little pattern. And
Yeah.
I also downloaded like her leaf pattern. She had a leaf pattern too that I downloaded as well. So for $2, it's totally worth
Well,
it.
you go on benders where you'll go a month without buying a pattern, and then the next month, oh, it's
And then I buy
on.
like 40. Yep.
Yeah.
By the way, all the copies of my patterns that y'all bought, that just rolled over into me going on a total pattern buying binge. Like I but then I also just add stuff to my cart, and once my cart gets to like 30, then I just binge sometimes and get a or I go through and I reassess if I really want
Yeah.
something, and then I binge. I'm like a bulimic pattern person.
Oh, insert our apology for using that as a
Yeah.
joke because it's not intended to be offensive. Also, if the video is freezing, I'm sorry. My son's probably playing some ridiculous game that's eating bandwidth. I forgot to tell him that I was recording, so. Usually, when I record, we put a kibosh on downloading things so that it doesn't kill our internet stream. So, finished objects. I have two finished objects. Yes, I have two finished objects this week. I finished the Rhinebeck sweater weather socks. This was just, these were plain stockinette socks with 64 stitches. They're sport weight with a true afterthought heel. And they are pretty well matched. Except the toes, for some reason, are not. Although they have the same number of stitches, so I'm not sure how that happened. Hmm. My gauge must have changed there or something. But the heels match, so I don't know. These are for me, because I love these colors lots and lots.
Very pretty. She just put up her Christmas colors.
Yes, I know. I got your text saying I need this. So.
Two. There are two, at least, that I need.
Yeah, I need to go and take a look at her colors. So that was... Those are my socks.
That was Nomadic Yarns?
Yeah, Nomadic Yarns or Nomadic Knits?
Yarns. Because okay. I always want to say Nomadic Knits because it's kind of a mnemonic, but it's...
Oh. Yeah, so Nomadic Yarns.
Almost alliteration.
The Rhinebeck Sweater Weather colorway. Mine was on the sport weight.
That's Ashley. Yep. Yes. What size needles did you use in those? 2.75, I see.
Yes,
that.
So a U.S. size 2, 2.75 millimeter. And the other thing that I finished is a big thing.
Yay, big thing.
My Rolling Rock sweater.
Ooh, cool.
Totally went somewhere else with that yay, big things, Joe. So this is finished. I put it in the dryer because it was still a little bit damp. It's a superwash, so it wasn't going to hurt it. So it's all done. I really like
the pattern. So that's a pattern by Thea Coleman, correct?
Correct. Thea Coleman of Baby Cocktails. The yarn is Hazelknits DK in the Alexandrite colorway. And I've got to put buttons on it. And once I put buttons on it, then I'll take...
Model.
I won't take pictures, because who am I kidding? I never take pictures, but I'll model. But I have to go to Joanne's this week and get some... Well, I've got a whole bag full of buttons I need to go through. I might have some. Because every time I go to, like, a festival or something, I'll grab some buttons. And so I've got a giant bag of, like, fancy buttons that I never use. So... it's done. I've tried it on, and it's a nice sort of casual fit, which is how it's intended. It's not intended to be a snug item. And I've got the little thumb holes somewhere. There they are.
Cool.
You can't really see that because it's a dark color. Anyway, I'll model next week once I've got buttons on it. Also, I'm in pajamas right now, so you don't need to see that. That's it. I do have some spinning, but you have spinning too.
I just have a wee bit of spinning. So the Hobbledehoy Batlings that she gave free in a goodie bag, I finished spinning those.
At Maryland?
Yep, at Maryland. So it is around 80 yards of a Navajo chain ply.
It's really pretty.
Thank you. It is a worsted weight. So make it maybe a good baby hat or something, or little bits and bobs, or striped with something, or... You know, it's a little bit of fun. And then, I didn't weigh it, but I would say it's probably around an ounce total. And then I started spinning up the patchwork kit from Hello Yarn. So this is the first bump that I spun. And this is the second. So I'm not certain if I'm going to ply those two together. I'm going to fill a bunch of bobbins. I have a lot of shocked bobbins, so I'll fill a bunch. And then decide which ones I want to ply together.
Yeah.
This is the kit that I wanted to ply together to do a blanket out of. So I'm going to go from there. So those are the first two bobbins of that. And I have another bobbin half filled. They're like little bumps of like leftover bits of her fiber. So I would say each bump is probably around an ounce, around about. And you get a pound for around $50, a little bit less than $50.
Yeah, so. Pretty well priced.
Oh yeah, it's just a fun little bits and bobs, fun to spin. It would be great to like spindle spin differently, all the little bumps and bobs. Yeah. But that is it for me for spinning. That's being spun on my ladybug, I should say that.
I actually have some spinning.
Yay! You're on a roll since Spinzilla.
Yeah, the next thing I think I'm going to spin are those bats that I impulse bought on while we were recording a couple weeks ago from Joanna Spring. They came several days after.
Oh, cool.
I just haven't had a chance to spin them because I've been working on this. So this is Knitty and Color in the Ain't It Fun colorway. It's 80% merino and 20% silk. It is a three ply, and I got 404 yards out of a three ply, which is the most I think I've ever gotten out of a three
That's
ply
gorgeous.
for 4 ounces. So it is not a fingering weight. I would say it's a sport weight, sort of kind of bordering on DK in spots. But I am still really happy with it because I ended with all the bobbins almost identical, which is always my biggest struggle. I always end up with way more on one bobbin than on the other. So when I finish, I'll end up with, an extra 30 or 40 yards of singles on one bobbin where the other two are empty. So this one was really close.
That's absolutely stunning.
So I really like the way this came out. It is a little bit darker than I would like, but that's the black silk is what happened, what made that happen. And I knew that it was going to happen. I just, in my brain, it was like, oh no, it's fine. It'll be bright. The lies
No,
that we tell
I love
ourselves.
it. Yeah, no, I think it looks great.
Yeah, I'm happy with it. So this is going to my friend Sue's the next time that I see her, which hopefully will be soon. She attacked herself with a cheese knife unintentionally. So I got that
Oh
fun picture the other day, and I was like, oh my God, call your husband. But if
no.
she's well enough to send me a picture, then clearly she's fine.
Oh my. That is craziness.
Yeah. So, anyway, she probably didn't want me just telling that story, but oh well, it's too late now. So
You do
that's.
have a book to review. Was there
Yes.
anything else that you wanted to say about your spinning? Do you have anything going on the wheel next? Those
The
bats?
Joanna Spring ones, I'll show next week.
Okay, great. We have a book to review. It is Short Row Knits by Carol Feller. Carol Feller has a great free craftsy class on Short Row Knits if you're not familiar with it. And then she also has a paid one that is definitely worth the money. It's one of my favorite craftsy classes I've taken. This is her new book called Short Row Knits. It retails for $22.99 in the US. This is not her first book ever. She did an Irish Knits a couple of years ago that was really good. That also has a lot of cables in it and has a good bit of different stuff. But
And this was sent to us to review by Potter Craft.
it was.
And it is a really comprehensive book on short rows. So she starts out by giving you illustrations on how there's four different main ways to do short rows. So
So
she.
there's the wrap and turn, the Japanese short rows, which are probably my personal favorite, actually. Then there are yarn over short rows, and then German short rows. And what I really like is she's got this picture comparing all four.
And it's
And she's
funny
just
that
done
you mention
it.
that Japanese is your favorite because I've never tried Japanese, but
Really?
looking through here, I'm like, I would hate that because you've got all this little crap happening on your as you're doing your short rows. You got either yarn stringing through there or, safety pins or locking stitch markers. But I can see that working really well for people who are very exact about the way that they do their knitting. I have a friend who, even on stockinette socks, keeps track of how many rows she does. And I can see something like this being really effective for that type of
That's the
knitter.
way Japanese short rows are how my sock pat the afterthought heels with a difference pattern that have the short rows and the afterthought heels. That's the technique that that's used
Okay.
in. So then we get into patterns, and each pattern uses different short rows for different techniques. So the first one is a braided bag, and the short rows are used to create those curved edges.
Yeah, it's bottom up, and so she uses short rows enabled to in order to give it that nice round bottom.
Yep. And that
And
uses two skeins of Malabrigo Rios, which is a superwash merino. I think it's interesting that they use that because it'll grow with time. Like, it wouldn't have much bounce back. So I might switch out that yarn choice. But really, really a pretty pattern. There are at least two pictures. So there's like the glam, like the lifestyle shot. Like, I just want to be this lady
Yeah.
walking
If I
through
make this bag, that's what
the
I'll look like. Yeah, the
Yeah.
life, yeah, the we're selling you the dream picture.
Yes, that's how I'm going to walk through on my way to work every day. Because obviously I walk to work every day. But so there's at least two pictures, usually one up close and one lifestyles, type picture. There's also a cabled hat that's knit from the front to the back of the head and uses short rows to curve its shape, and that is the Frio cabled hat.
Yeah, and so it's knit, once you've done the in the round, the ribbing, it's actually knit sort of from your forehead going up over your head and then down towards the back of your head.
Yeah, so kind of like the, there you go, that's a better picture where you can see the little, like, wedges.
Yep.
So kind of like that aviator baby hat, if you're familiar with that construction. Very similar to that in the construction, and that uses a very nice clear cable chart, easy to read, and it uses short rows, obviously, to do it.
I actually thought this Chiripo short row ball, so it's intended as like a child's toy, but it's got several wedges that you end up joining at the end. So it's got, I don't know how many wedges, I should probably have read that in the pattern, but you could try out all the different short row techniques in that one pattern and see which one really works for you. I think that would be a good way to test out all the different methods to see which one appeals to you.
Yeah. There is the Toro Cardi with shawl collar, which is really pretty, and that shawl collar is where you get the short rows for the most part. It is sized from 31 up to 58 and a half, so a good range, but I do want to note that there is a big jump between the sizes. So it's a 31, and it does to fit bust circumference and then the finished bust circumference, so you get an idea of ease that way. But it's to fit bust circumference 31, 35 and a half, 40 and a fourth, 44 and three fourths, 49 and a fourth, 53 and a half, and 58 and a half. And I would assume that would be because of the stitch pattern repeat.
Yeah, and then it's a heavyweight yarn. Yeah.
Yeah, as someone who's between the 44 and the 49. That's a, I mean, that's 5 inches.
Yeah, basically. It's 4 to 5 inches in between each size.
So that's important to kind of know. It uses Lorna's Lace's worsted, which is a nice worsted weight superwash yarn. Lovely, very, very clear schematic and very large schematic. The schematic itself takes up the entire page. So very easy to see and read exactly where stuff is. Then we get into the second chapter, which is short row shaping. And it has a section at the beginning on how short rows can be used to do triangles, going left sloped, right sloped, double sloped, and another direction double slope, like double slope down versus double slope up. Very clear charts and explanations on how to do that. And every picture is in a slightly different color. So it's easy to see and differentiate. And then there's a section on creating 2D shawl shapes with short rows. So, and short row heels and 3D curves. So there's a lot of information in here.
Yeah.
I think this is the most comprehensive short row book that I've ever seen. We don't, you don't see a whole lot of short row
specialty. Right.
Yeah, specialty books. And this does a great job with that, obviously from the title, but it's a technique with some cool patterns as well.
So there's the Tempest, oh God, I'm sorry, I'm terrible at pronunciation. The Tempescue striped garter stitch shawl. So it's got several colors going on, as well as stockinette versus stripes, but at no point are you handling more than one color at a time.
There's another picture, so you can kind of get a feel for it.
My only complaint about some of the accessories is that you don't get a good full-on picture of what the accessory looks by, like, not necessarily by itself, but like you see pieces of this shawl, but you never see all of it at once.
Yeah. And there's no schematic really to show you the shape.
Right, not in the accessories, yeah. Well, except the specialty one, which we'll come to.
So the next one is Celeste Curve Lace Wrap, which I really like. It uses actually the Bare Naked Wool Stone Soup DK. And that one is curved with a lace detail at the bottom. I really like that one. I think it's extremely wearable. And it uses Japanese short rows. It's got like a picot bind off, very clear lace chart. And just, I think it's a great wrap to kind of throw on. Does it, On sizes, it does say that your finished size is 67 by 20, so it's nice and long with a shorter depth from those short rows.
So next is the Diamante center out shawl.
That one does have a schematic.
Yeah,
It
and I
looks
do
like
think that
that.
it's cleverly done because it's center out for the lace pattern, and then you bind off on two of the lace sections, and the other two you continue to go until you've got these garter sections that make up the shoulders, which I think is a really clever way to do it. I might have done it slightly differently just because I prefer my shawl is a little wider, but I do appreciate that it's a whole new way to make a shawl. I've not seen that before.
Then there's socks. There's a very basic top-down sock, which I really feel like could have been skipped. They could have filled that pattern room with a little bit more of an interesting, but it's just a simple short row heel pattern. I don't know. That didn't do it for me. I think there's a lot of short row heel patterns out there for free that
I hear
you
what you're
probably
saying.
could have gotten more bang for your buck. There's also a cabled toe-up sock. Again, with a short row heel.
That's also using bare naked wools. There's a couple things I don't love. Just
And that one also used a short row toe as well.
I'm not super crazy about this Lamone side-to-side hat, but that's more of a just a personal taste issue, knowing what I can pull off and what I can't. I do appreciate the construction is one that I haven't seen before, and of course that is sort of a it's side to side, that's in the title. And it is sort of a beret-ish
I
style.
love this next one though, the zapote child's hooded jacket. It's a hooded jacket. The hood is short rowed, so it's knit from the top down using short rows to shape that hood. And then the shoulders are shaped with raglan increases, and it's got pockets. So I could definitely see this being an Alice type hoodie for sure. It is sized from 6 months, which is a 19 and one-fourth actual chest circumference, up to 10 years. So there is, which is a 30 and a half. So there are a wide range of sizes. There's a very clear schematic. So I could definitely see using that.
The next section is for short rows and garments. And so I like that this has the beginning of the section sort of tells you the different areas where you might use short rows, like in the back of the neck to bring that up. I like that she's added this detail about the back hem where you can do sort of a scoop in the back hem, which is a newer to me style on a sweater, but one that I'm interested in creating.
She uses it on side-to-side sweaters for hip shaping, and that is, and then sleeve caps, of course, but I thought that side-to-side hip shaping was really an interesting use. And then bust darts.
Yeah, she's got a whole worksheet here for how you can calculate what bust darts that you might need into your own garments, which I appreciated. It wasn't just this is how you figure it out. It's what's this number multiplied by this number divided by this number. It's very specific.
So the first pattern in the section is the Itiro Colorwork Sweat Yoke Sweater. It uses short rows on the back neck, which you see a lot with yoke sweaters.
I really
It's
like this
got that
pattern.
cool pocket detail that is the cover sweater.
It's knit in a worsted weight and Harrisville Designs.
It's size 31 up to 55, and it's around 3 inches between each size. So 31, 34, 37, 40, 43, 46, 49, 52, and 55. There is some back detail. There's a back detail shot, which I always appreciate.
And
It's
this
a
is the
little
cover
bit big
sweater.
on the model, but it
Yeah.
looks good overall.
But I think with a heavier weight sweater like that, you want it to be a little loose. So I can see the styling for that. There's the Tamarindo Raglan Waterfall Cardigan.
It's a very pretty lace cardigan. Again, sized 30 up to
54.
54, with sizes around every 4 inches or so. It uses blue Moon Fiber Arts lacing, so in size 6 needles. So
It's a very drapey, pretty
Great for warm weather areas, I would say.
A thin sort of layering piece, but a very pretty one.
Very floppy collar on it.
The Legato Dolman pullover is one that I felt like could use more pictures, because it's hard for me to really see what's happening here. So it's a Dolman sweater.
Looks like the short rows. This is my problem with this, is the short rows go right here. So it's kind of like pointing an arrow right here. So on me, that's an area that I don't need attention drawn to.
And then there's this is the only other picture, and it's a back view. So I
but
would
if
like
you have a perfectly flat stomach and are cute, that could, well, perfectly flat stomach, that could definitely work for you.
Yeah. I do, I think it's a cool construction. I like that it's got sort of those swoop effect to the sides. Although for me, it would just look like saddlebags. I think that it would be really unflattering for...
Yeah, and that bottom is a drop stitch section. So it's like double loops that are drops. You can see the elongated stitches. So that's going to even draw more attention there. Yeah.
I do like the Dolman sleeves, though. And I do like that she used a Noro to sort of give it that almost hand-spun effect.
Yeah, and you can. She says if you want it to be more subtle, you can always do a solid color. And you won't be able to see as much of the short row shaping with the swoop.
I really want this next sweater, but I really don't want to knit it. Mainly because it's knit in lace on, well, I mean, it's knit on size 5, which is good, but it's also 2,000 yards of lace. So it's the Rito oversized sweater, and it's got the, gosh, what are those sleeves called? Drop sleeves, drop shoulder. But it's got that longer hem, which I'm really into.
It's very boxy looking on the model.
But I dig it. I like it. And that, again, all the items in here are sized pretty well. This one's 30 up to 55 with about 3 inches in between each size.
Well, I feel like it's more flattering than just a boxy sweater because of that curved hem.
Yeah. And I
that kind of gives it the illusion of.
It's also got this cool short row detailing right on the shoulder. That sort of, I don't know, it gives that the shoulder a little something extra.
There it is from the front.
Yeah, so I dig this sweater a lot. I would like to own it. I would not like to make it.
There's also some side-by-side pieces that I'm going to kind of skip over. And then there's a Salto.
We have to show this one. This is the Jimenez. Side-to-side linen top, and we have to show it because it's Jimenez. It makes me think of Jinx. Laura, that's her last name.
I know that's her last name. It has a back hem, which you can kind of see.
Dig it. It's knit, it's just, you start in the middle back, and then you go around to the front, and then you come back in the back, and you come around the other side.
Stitches.
Yeah, it's knit in a linen, so it's intended to be a layer. It's not intended to be worn by itself because it's see-through.
Yep.
But I dig it.
That's from a 29 up to a 53.
Yeah.
I was totally skipping that one.
I mean, it's got sort of a distressed effect to it, but I don't know. I think it's interesting. I'd like to see it on a bigger girl.
All right. So Salto, which has a satin sleeve. That's my, I'm disagreeing with you, but
you're allowed to disagree. That's totally acceptable.
I like this one. It says from a 31 up to a 55, again, satin sleeves. It's got increases and decreases that mimic cables. And this short rows are used to do the sleeve cap. That's how the sleeve cap is shaped. It uses a DK weight from Hedgehog Fibers, which is really, really pretty. Size 6 needles, nice clear cardigan. There's the arm detail, which I think is very flattering. It's kind of pointing up towards the model's face, which I enjoy, the stitch pattern in general. It's kind of, it's not cables, but it's got kind of a cable feel to it.
It's definitely got triangles. Like dimension to it. To me, I would be constantly trying to flatten it out. but I do like that it's got that dimension to it, but it almost looks like it's knit too densely for me. Again, that's personal taste that Carol Feller's been knitting longer than I've been alive, probably. So, She's definitely the expert here.
There are two more sweaters. Both have cables. There's the Estrella cardigan with bust shaping, so you can see the cables there in the front panel. This is a heavier weight sweater. It uses a worsted, but
this is another one I really wish I could see it front on, because they use hooks and eyes instead of a zipper or
you can
buttons.
See the eye on the.
But I would really like to see it front on.
Yep.
I do like that detail on the edging. I do think that's cool.
I think it's cool with the cable edging. She does do tell you if you need more, if you need larger bust shaping, that you will need to get more yarn, which is something to be considerate of. So she does just small dart. The back collar is interesting. I need a closer picture of that. Do you see how it's kind of like, because of the cable?
Yeah. I'd be interested to see how that looks. I'm sure on Ravelry there are better pictures. I haven't gone out to dig through that. In a book, you're limited on space, so you have to really
pick
the ones that give the best impact. So
there is a great technique section to this.
Mm-hmm.
So that is Short Row Knits. It is a master workshop for sure, with 20 projects in it as well. It retails for $22.99 in the US, $30 in Canada. It is a net, like, if you are interested in short rows at all, even designing with short rows, I feel like this would be a good reference book to have in your repertoire.
There are several patterns in here that I like. So I could say, you know, I think that there's a general rule of thumb. If there's X number of patterns in a book that you like, then you should buy it. And if this were something I were looking through at a bookstore, I probably would buy it, because there are at least three items in here that I would make.
Oh yeah. And there's a good reference section, and I'm always looking for better reference sections on something like the slip stitch book sitting right there. That's why I said that. On Short Row Knits, there's not a lot of references out there about short rows, and Carol Feller does a great job. Her craftsy classes, like I said earlier, man, are really, really good. And one of them is free. So all you have to do is sign up on Craftsy, and she kind of goes over. But the longer one is much more comprehensive.
So speaking of Craftsy, we are Craftsy affiliates.
We are.
So if on our website, TheKnitGirllls3Ls.com, if you click on the Craftsy link through our website, and then go on to purchase anything, whether it's classes or supplies, we do get a tiny little kickback of that. So if you're considering purchasing any Craftsy class or supplies, try to click on it through our site, because we get a tiny little bit of that.
That would be wonderful. We do have a question from Patricia Loves Yarn. She says, hello, lovely ladies. I have a question. I prefer hat patterns that are brim up and socks that are top down. We all have our thing we like, right? When I see a hat pattern that is top down, is it okay to knit it brim up and just follow the pattern backwards? Mostly what I am questioning is if it's a cable pattern. And could you do the same with a sock pattern, knit it top down from a toe pattern? Do people do this all the time? Thank you so much. I've learned a lot from watching your podcast and love it. So there are some reasons why people do top-down hat patterns. Sometimes it's because of a brim technique or something else. But
the basic answer is yes.
Yes, you can. I wish I had something with charts. Ooh,
if you are knitting and you like the result, then you are doing it right.
So let's look at a chart. So let me find a random chart in this book. Not that one. That's a color work chart. That's not going to be super helpful. So if you are knitting the opposite, here's a slip stitch pattern. If you are knitting the opposite direction, so let's say this calls for it to be toe up and you want to knit it from top down, you want to start the chart up here if you want it to look the same and work your way down, versus traditionally you start at the bottom and work your way up. I think that's more important with, like, cables for the most part, or asymmetrical shaped charts, rather than something like this that's basically the same from,
if you're working on something like a hat, where it's going to get smaller if you're doing it brim up, or bigger if you're doing it crown down, then wherever it has a decrease, then you want to substitute an increase.
Yes.
But yes, you can. I mean, there's no law that says that you can't. You just have to be confident enough in how you're modifying it in order to accomplish what you're out there doing. I would say it would not be okay if you decide to totally change a pattern's construction and then bother the designer constantly about how would I do it if I'm doing it this way, totally not the way that you wrote it, help me fix it. Like,
Yeah,
that
that's
can sort of be bordering on not cool. But yes, you absolutely can do it, you know, the opposite way of how it's written. You just have to be able
Yeah.
to be confident that you can do it.
I'm glad you
And
brought that up because that's an interesting thing.
whenever I write, this isn't necessarily pertaining to the question, but whenever I write a designer, if I'm having a problem and I've counted 1,000 times and I know in my brain, like, this isn't matching up, because of, I don't know, being raised in the South, maybe, I started out with, I'm probably wrong, but can you
I'm
just tell
99%
me?
wrong, yeah.
Yeah, and I've done that with Wendy of Wendy Knit several times where I'll be like, this isn't right. And then she'll be like, yes, it is. Count your stitch. Well, she's very nice about it. She's not ugly about it. But so, whoo, we went off on a little tangent there. I did, anyway. So I'd say, yes, you absolutely can. You just want to pay attention to directionality if it's a cable or lace, or if it's asymmetrical, like Laura mentioned. And substitute increases for decreases, or vice versa, if you're changing
Yeah.
direction. That's all I got.
And don't expect free pattern support, like pattern support for free if you change the
Right.
designer's directionality and want them to help you change that.
Yeah.
Especially if it's a free pattern, I would say. So, not that it matters in that case
Yeah.
for any pattern, really. That is about it for that. I hope that helped a little bit,
Yeah.
Patricia.
Also, for the record, Patricia, I knit my hats and socks the exact same way. Brim up for hats and top down for socks, usually.
I like doing top-down hats. They're fun. Meh. And I do toe-up socks.
Nobody's the boss of you.
Meh. Except for you. I am listening when we're going to talk about our reading. I just finished reading today, Tell Me by Joan Bauer. It is a new book that she came out with. It is about a girl whose family is going through a bit of difficulty. Her father is having some anger management problems, and in order for her parents to work with a therapist on kind of getting through the situation, they send her to live with her paternal grandmother for the summer. And there is like a big parade events festival that her grandmother basically leads every year. It's the Flower Festival. And so she goes to live with her grandmother in this very small town. And she is also like a budding actress. So it's a lot about her and gaining self-confidence and also her dealing with her parents' situation. But she is a dancing petunia one day at the library steps trying to get people to come to the festival, and she sees a girl kind of being roughly treated, and the girl's kind of dragged into the girl's bathroom by this woman, and just something feels off to her. And so she reports it, and the librarian listens because she kind of saw the treatment, but she didn't see the vehicle or anything. And they end up being very persistent with it. And it turns out that it was a human trafficking type issue. And it really, it's definitely a middle grade type novel. It's not a YA. I love Joan Bauer. She's one of my favorite authors. So I'm going into this with a bias. But it touches on that issue very well for, it's like a good entry into a discussion that you can have with your kids about what human trafficking is and how that still occurs in the world today. So it's a good talking about novel for sure. So I really enjoyed that. I love anything by Joan Bauer, and I was fortunate enough to meet her at IRA a couple of years ago, the International Reading Association conference, and she is like the sweetest person ever. So she is always, I always read when she comes out with a new book, and that one just happened to be in the book fair, so I snatched it up.
Cool.
I am currently listening to on Audible Carry On by Rainbow Royal Roll, It is the accompanying book to Fangirl. So in Fangirl, which is a really, really good YA book, it is an upper level YA book. I would say 16 years old and up at the very minimum. In that book, which is a realistic fiction book, one of the main characters writes fan fiction, and Carry On is the fan fiction that she writes in that book. So it is, you have to let the fact that you know it's fan fiction if you've read Fangirl, that it does have a lot of similarities to some degree to Harry Potter, you gotta let that go. It is a great book. It will stand alone on its own. The Audible is like 14 hours. And I started listening to it on my drive back from Knoxville yesterday, and I could not stop listening. Like, I came in and continued listening to it. So I have 3 hours still left. I had saved it for that trip. So it's really, really good. It is definitely an older book. It has a lot of adult language. It has a lot of adult situations. It has some boy-on-boy kissing. So it's got some stuff that some people might object to. So just keep that in mind if you're trying to select it for or recommending it for someone else. It's definitely more of an adult YA. I feel like YA, you know, starts kind of at 14, and there's some things like at 14 that's pretty appropriate for my kids. But Rainbow's stuff is definitely more high school. I still love it, and it's great for me. Like, she's one of my absolute favorite authors, but it's one that I would not feel comfortable recommending to a middle school age child.
And definitely even the Mississippi School Board will not feel comfortable.
No, and the conservative area that I'm in, I'm not certain that I would feel comfortable recommending it to a high school age child. But everyone knows their kid the best.
Yep.
And the children that you're recommending it to. And so if that works for you, I always recommend reading book reviews before you purchase something that I talk about. Definitely. If there's something that anyone can object to, someone on Amazon is going to object to.
Oh,
it.
Yeah. Someone just click on that one-star review and you go read it and see what they're complaining
yeah.
about.
As someone on Goodreads is going to object to it. So I love her stuff, but you know, you gotta do what's right for your kids or for you. It's definitely a personal preference. So anyway, those are the two books that I am reading. What are you reading, my friend?
A bunch of smut stuff that I'm not going to share. not a bunch. I really haven't read a whole lot this week because my old lady clamp thing that clamps
yeah.
onto the bed, I broke it.
How did you break that? That sounds very serious.
So it's got like this metal. So there's the clamp, right? The clamps onto the frame. And then there's the gooseneck thing that's flexible. It's like a metal flexible neck. And then there's the part that holds the tablet. Well, between the part that holds the tablet and the gooseneck, there's like a ball joint, so you can move the tablet
yeah.
around and adjust
so
it and
like
everything.
Kind of like on my little thing, like that area that swivels.
Yeah, it's like the little yeah. ball joint.
Yeah, right
And
there.
Instead of me repositioning using the gooseneck like you're supposed to, I was using the tablet part, and so it cracked, right? Because it like sheared the screw right in half. So I'm writing the company to see if they'll send me a replacement part. Hopefully they will, and I won't have to buy a whole new thing because I use that sucker all the time. But anyway, I'm listening to Queen of Shadows, which is the
Throne of Glass.
Fourth, I think, in the Throne of Glass, but it's not the
Glass.
Last one. It's the last one that's out, but I think there's one more coming out.
Okay.
But it's not until next year. And I was debating like putting off listening to this one because I hate not being able to listen to a whole series, but I'm really enjoying it, so I'm listening to it. And then I didn't put it on here, but Brandon Sanderson came out with a new one in the Mistborn series.
Really?
And I haven't read Mistborn in probably 2 years, so I've sort of forgotten. I know they sort of control metal elements, kind of. That's sort of all I remember.
I couldn't get into Mistborn.
It was. It's definitely more of a hard science fiction than most, so but I'm gonna reread it, so I need to put that on there. I am rereading the Mistborn series because the new one is Shadows of Self, And that's...
Ooh, I might have a new book coming out on Amazon.
And that's the fifth in the series. Mm-hmm. But I have to go back and read the other ones, which is good, because I like rereading books.
I love rereading books. It is not... I'm rereading Alana Andrews' Burn for Me right now. That's, like, my night reading. So... But I want the next one in that series to come out for sure. But, yeah, I'm a rereader.
You know what's funny is I've only read the one series of Alana Andrews.
The Kate Daniels?
Yes. And mm-hmm. In my head, I'm like, there will never be a better protagonist than Curran. Curran is pretty amazing.
I think you'll like this one.
Like, I heart Curran.
I do too, but I really like Mad.
So Rogan. What's that series? It's the Kate Daniels series, right?
The Kate Daniels series is the one with Curran.
Right. Really, I'm just like, saying if people are asking.
Yeah, so Alana Andrews has three or four series. I just reread Clean Sweep because the new one in that series, they did, that was available for free and they release it in segments, but that format does not work for me. It does not work for my brain. I can't keep up with what happened. So I just wait till spend $2 and they've re-edited it. So the new Clean Sweep one might be out now. I was just looking. I have so many books on I pre-order stuff for my Kindle.
Yeah.
And I know like four or five are coming out in November, but I'm hoping some come out tonight because I have a teacher work day tomorrow.
Ooh, I have one that's coming out tonight. What is it?
I don't know. It is coming out.
I remember it was November. Oh no, never mind. It's next week.
I have a bunch. Like, November, December is... November is a huge time for new romance novels, if nothing else, to come out, because they're trying to capitalize on that pre-Christmas market. The new Janet Ivanovich comes out this month, for sure. So there's a lot. And there's a lot of... I did not want to click on Ravelry. I wanted to click on
Amazon. You know what I was just thinking?
Later.
We only talk knitting for, like, 15 minutes. And the rest of this is like a lifestyle podcast. It's not even knitting anymore.
I'm not certain that anyone wants our lifestyle. We're hermits that stay at home and read and knit.
And I'm wearing pajamas, and there are thousands of people who are going to watch me, and I don't care. So.
It's fine. I'm still in my dress slacks from work, although I did throw on a t-shirt because I'm washing like all my clothes from this
weekend. Oh my God, stand up. I want to see you in a t-shirt and dress slacks. No, I'll show you my pajamas.
No, I'm not going to do it. It's not gonna happen.
You're such a slacker.
Nope, not gonna happen. So favorite things. I went to SAF, which is the Southeastern Animal and Fiber Festival, which is in Asheville, North Carolina. I'm totally changing the topic because we're not talking about me in dress pants.
It's very subtle.
It was. So I drove down to Knoxville Thursday night. I am not doing that drive at night anymore. Like, from here to Nashville is fine. And once you get past Nashville, those last 2 hours in the dark, because it's, like, pitch black. Mm-hmm. And it's mountains, and it's super curvy, and it's, like, 55 miles an hour, and I hate it.
Yeah.
So I really, really hate it. I'm not doing that drive anymore at night. It's going to happen in the daytime, because there's, like, all these semis, and it just stresses me out. So I had to stop and get more Diet Dr. Pepper and... crunchy M&Ms to keep myself
have
like,
you gotten sucked going. On them because I totally have gotten sucked on them.
Yes, and that sharing size instead of king size now. I like will share with one of my people at work like four M&Ms, so I feel better about buying a sharing size for me. But so I got there on Friday. My grandmother was there too. She is going to be 81 soon, which is really, really cool. That's my mom's mom. And so Friday, we went to Trader Joe's, which is the best store ever. There's not one in Memphis, and it makes me sad. My closest one is Nashville. I don't think there's one in Mississippi at all.
I don't think there is. There wasn't when I lived there.
No, I think it's Mississippi free. So we went to Trader Joe's, and I bought all the freeze-dried bananas that could possibly fit. And I also tried your Not My Father's Root Beer.
Yeah.
Is good. It's like a sipping drink.
Yeah, it's like an ale sort of, but yeah. I like it.
So, and then we went to the UT volleyball game, which was lots and lots of fun. Guess how much it is to get into a Division I college girls volleyball game?
$7,000. I have no idea.
$3.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so if I lived close, I would go all the time. It was great, cheap entertainment. It was really fun and really interesting to watch the adults play. Like, there were most of the people on the team are like 6'4".
So what prompted you guys to go to a volleyball game? Just
My father wants to go see different sports
okay.
that are available at
Just
UT.
curious.
So, yeah, and I like volleyball, obviously. So
You are the coach, I hear.
I'm not the coach, I'm the bookkeeper, the scorekeeper. So no, it was fun. It was lots of fun. I actually took some videos to show my girls today,
That's
like on the
cool.
volleyball team, and they were very excited. Like jump serves were like to them, so they enjoyed it. And then Saturday we went to SAF. We got up at 5:30 in the morning so we could leave by 6.
Oh, was it? How far of a drive was it?
It's like two, a little over 2.5 hours from Knoxville.
Did Wheeze go?
Yeah, we drove, and my grandmother and my mom went.
How long
So,
of a drive would it have been if your mother drove?
2 hours. Well, there's a section of 40 that you don't go on when you drive up north, but when you go from Knoxville to Asheville, there's a section, and it is super curvy, and it's like cattle chutes the whole way. And like, I don't like driving it because I don't know, I'm getting old and don't like driving stuff like that anymore. But it stresses me out because there's semis can't go in the left lane, so you pass in the left lane, but it's cattle chutes and it's real curvy and it just stresses me out. But so went to Asheville, which I love. It's a great town. And went to SAF, and SAF was so much fun. Like crazy fun. I'm totally going back. This was my first time ever going, and they've changed the venue from years in the past. They moved it, the tractor show has been moved or something, so they moved it into the part that was the tractor show. There are tons of vendors. There's also outdoor vendors as well. That's where Lost City Knits was and Carolina Spinner. It was so much fun getting to talk to people. The very first place I went was Miss Babs. I got a skein of yarn for a sweater for Alice. This is Yowza in the Lori colorway. This is really, really pretty. I also got a skein for my friend Lynn in the SAF specific colorway. There was no line. Not a single person in line. I just walked up and paid. I got a chance to talk to both Jen, who I've missed terribly,
I saw her at Rhinebeck, but she was like entertaining people in line, so I didn't want to bug her.
and then Babs. Babs told me to tell everyone that the rumors of her line at Rhinebeck have been greatly exaggerated. She was asked, they had three registers and it
Oh
only
yeah,
was for 5 minutes.
they were pumping
So
people
they were
through.
pumping
Now,
people
let's
through.
clarify. There was a huge line, but the
Yes.
wait wasn't exceedingly terrible. It was like Laura said, at the
Babs
busiest
said
times about
45
45
minutes.
minutes.
So she was saying that Clara Parks put 2 hours in her newsletter, and we had heard 4 hours. So she's like, no, y'all are wrong. That was
So
exaggerated.
Babs, we stand
We're
corrected.
sorry. So this is gorgeous. And she'll be at SSK, and it was fun to talk to her. I love their Yowza. It's gorgeous. So that's gonna be a cool little car pullover for Alice that's got pockets in it. So I'm excited about that. And then I went to Gail's booth, and Gail only brought like 15 saplings, and she sold out the first day. And I was teasing her because like while I was standing there, probably 10 people came up and asked her if she had saplings. And I was like, you just need to wear a t-shirt that says, I did not bring saplings. So she is reopening her shop on Friday. There will be pre-orders for sock blanks there. She has hired a dye assistant,
Oh,
so she will be
awesome.
able to produce more sock blanks more quickly. But she's doing pre-orders for everyone. So if you are interested in like the ornament sock blank for Christmas, she'll have those up in the shop soon, Friday. So she had one skein of this left.
That
And I
makes me
had
think of like gingerbread and
her
Christmas.
peppermint candy.
Oh, is that her peppermint bark one?
Uh-huh.
Oh,
This is her
cool.
peppermint candy. This is the Wonder Sock yarn. It is superwash BFL and nylon, 465 yards. This is going to become my Christmas socks this year if I get my acts together.
Oh, that's cool.
Like if I do the Grinch along, I'm not gonna do the Grinch along because I'm never going to get it done. The Grinch along is a cowl put on by the Knitmore Girls, and it's you stop gift knitting on December 1st, but I don't think I'll be that far ahead of my gift knitting. And the purpose is so that you're not stressed out
Right.
around the holidays. but I want to make this into socks for me because it is really, really pretty.
Yeah, I dig it.
My grandmother, as we were walking around, saw people with fingerless mitts like Jane and informed me that she would like fingerless mitts for Christmas.
Oh, that's awesome.
Because her old ones had worn out. So that is what she's getting from probably out of Handspun. So I bought that. I bought some fudge. I convinced Mama Linneman that she should buy me some signature needles for Christmas, which she did. So I'm getting some size 5 DPNs for Christmas from Mama Linneman. Then I walked down and saw Gerber Shuby. I got to meet some really awesome fans. Like, there were so many nice people, and they would drag their husbands or significant others up too. Which was so much fun. It was fun talking to there. Like, there was time also to talk to people.
Mm-hmm.
So that was great. I got to see Elizabeth of Spotted Circus. I got to see, and she's doing some, she got a sock machine. And so she's doing gradients now too. Oh, in cool. yarn, which is really cool. I got to meet Gerber Shuby, who, does the Transient Wool Merchant podcast with, Amy of Ross Farms. So I got to meet her for the first time. I feel like I already know her because I listened to their podcast. Amy and her husband, Scooter Pie, were right next door. And I bought a skein of Henrietta. So this is a 3-ply sport, 250 yards. It's Shetland. It's a soft Shetland. I think I'm going to use this with my Kate Davies yarn, maybe.
Oh, that's cool.
It's like an extra color. So I got this, and then I saw I said hi to Wandering Wool.
Joelle,
who was really, really sweet. And then I met someone I'm going to bring up. I'm terrible with names, but her name also began with a J. One of our listeners who was in that booth, who was the sweetest person. And that was, she was so sweet. Veronica, it's not a J. I'm a total liar. So there's me with Veronica and Wandering Wool's booth. And she was so sweet. And her friend was there. And she just started knitting, like, less than a year ago and has already almost finished her first sweater.
Oh, like, wow.
Gorgeous, yes. So Veronica was lots of fun. I got to hang out with the Carolina Fiber girls for a little while because they were in class with me. And then the only other skein of yarn, so I only bought 4. This is Gorgeous Gradient. And it is from Apple Tree Knits Yarn, and I saw her at Stitches and never made it back over there. And her father, who is sweet, she's from New Jersey.
Mm.
Her father was the sweetest, and he was working the booth for her because she was like 8.5 months pregnant with twins.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. So, he was, you could tell he was so proud of his daughter, like sweetest. And I meant to get back over there and somehow never got back over there. But this is 6 ounces or 840 yards. It's a one-of-a-kind gradient. And it was $48, which I thought was really, really good.
I like how Mom got softly that gradiates out.
I do, too. She had even, she had, like, all different bases for her gradients, including lace weight up to, like, a super bulky. So I thought that was really, really neat. Yeah. And they were all different. Like, this one was 840 yards, but beside it was, like, a 600-yard, and beside that was, like, 1500 yards, so it was what you wanted. So this will be a shawl sometime.
And that's called what? Apple Tree?
Apple Tree Knits Yarn.
I'm totally looking that up right now.
She is really sweet, and she is from Jersey. She's from North Jersey. Mom got a really one that I really wanted in worsted, but I let her have it because she's my mom. I didn't grab it out of her hand.
They don't reopen until Wednesday because of SAF. They're traveling.
And then I went to my Franklin Habit class, which was really, really good. It was photographing your knits, and, I sat beside P Hobbs, and there were lots of cool people there, including Tracy and the Carolina Fiber girls, and just so many neat people in general. It was a great class, mostly lecture based. It was interesting because I've also taken Gail Zucker's photography class, mm-hmm. and two very different approaches. So if you've taken one, I would definitely recommend taking the other. So that was 3 hours, and then I packed everything up and hung out with Chef Caroline and went out to Lost City Knits and talked to them. They are carrying the Jameson sweater weight now, not just
that's really cool
lace weight. So next time I'll see them in January in Oxford, totally gonna get some of that. They had a sheep head hat, the Kate Davies pattern that made up as a sample that was really, really nice. Great vendors. I bought fudge too, which I haven't eaten yet, but I got my fudge. I bought more fudge than I was expecting. I got like three different kinds instead of the two that I brewed.
Whatever.
Whatever.
It's a memory thing.
Yeah. I convinced mom that Wheezy's birthday is this week on Saturday. He'll be older.
Was gonna say, you better not.
He was hilarious. Like, walking around the market with Wheezy is ridiculously funny. So he will stop. If people are taking a picture, he'll stop and he'll be like, "Do you want me to take it so you can be in the picture?" Like, he stops all. Like, he was getting annoyed because viewers were stopping me. And I was like, "You're just as bad because you stop to take everyone's picture for them."
That's good karma, though.
He's the mayor. So it was lots of fun. We'll go back. Mom really liked it. I did not get a chance to go out and see the animals, but Wheezy Trout was trying to convince a llama to kiss him. I'm not certain he was successful, but there were kissing llamas and there were sheep I've heard, and he took a lot of pictures of the Jacob sheep. And it's funny. And there's also a flea sale, and Judith McKenzie did the judging this year, but that was Friday, so I missed it.
Yeah.
And I didn't buy any fleece.
Good for you. You didn't really have
And
time to go through the market.
Keeper Hollow Farm also did an update yesterday. Did not buy any fleece. So I tried to, but the one I wanted was sold. Well,
So not for lack of trying.
I was driving and, I wasn't really checking my email. But yeah, it was a CVM RAM. It's meat market time. So this year before they go to market. So that is about it. For me. Oh no, I have a Halloween swap that I did. And then we have the craft all the things to give out prizes for. And then we have the ancient arts to give out prizes for. So I did a swap. This is from A1 Dowin. I did the Halloween swap in the I'll Knit With You podcast group, which is a great video podcast. She does around one a month. This is kind of beat up. She knit a little catnip thing for her birthday.
Aww.
She's just been loving it. Just rolling around on it. It's got Humberto fuzz on it. And her parents had grown the catnip. And then I got a skein of Fleece Artist in Sea Storm in the
Wow.
sea wool base, which is a great base. It's funny, I actually sent her many skeins, and one of them was out of the sea wool base. And then she sent me some gummy worms, which don't exist anymore, except in my belly, and some strawberry cheesecake. Awesome. Chocolate and some tea, which I'm super excited about. A berry white tea and an Uncle Philbert's nutty dessert tea, which is a black tea. So I'm very excited about those. So thank you. Was super sweet. And Humberto loves this. The catnip. He is crazed. He doesn't need any more of that. So, but he's been carrying it around like it's his little baby. So that was lots and lots of fun. I need to make sure she got her package because it was supposed to arrive on Thursday. We have the Halloween Craft All the Things is sadly over.
Yes.
Very sad. So we have some drawings for there. So how many skeins of yarn is Jess giving away? Jess is
Two.
doing hand spun, right?
Two skeins of hand spun. I don't know that we have all our prizes together to give it away today, do we?
I have mine. Do you have yours?
I have the Rite of Color. And then we also have a pattern to give away for Boston Jen.
Okay. Are those the two that you have?
I think so.
And then I have three here.
And then two of Jess's hand-spun skeins.
Okay. So let's do two of Jess's hand spun skeins first. She's going to mail them directly to the winner.
So if you win one of these two skeins, you need to private message Jess, show me your knits. If you want to, you can just go on our group homepage on Ravelry, and she's listed as a moderator at the bottom. You can just click it there if you want.
She is.
And she's amazing for donating hand spun. I keep telling her she doesn't need to, and then she gets offended, like hers isn't good enough, and I'm like, yours is too good.
Yeah.
Okay, let me pull up random messenger, random number generator. So we're pulling from people who have posted in the thread with any finished item. Doesn't have to be knitting.
Yep, and it is from between 2 and 8:38.
Whoa.
I know, we had a lot going on.
Okay, so between 2 and 8:38, I'll generate the first number is 809. So that'll be on not the last page, but the next to the last page.
I'm sorry, the top of the last page has maple syrup cotton candy, like maple syrup candy made in pig shape. And I feel like you have to look at it. It's post 826.
I want some.
It's a little hip kitty. All right, what was the winner post?
809.
All right, I'm going to go look at that while you go look at the maple syrup cotton candy pigs. Not cotton candy. Maple syrup candy pigs. All right, that is Pearly93. It's a little horse pulled the cart of wagons for my apple crisp before joining his boss, the headless horseman. It is very cute. Aragurumi crocheted little horse. And so Pearly93, if you will PM Jess, she will get with you.
Little Hip Kitty is Jess with Dream and Color, right?
She doesn't work for Dream and Color anymore. Okay. They moved to like
Everett, Washington. That's where her Ravelry. I'm sorry, I'm stalking you, Jess. she's in Washington now. I want some of that candy.
So she moved too.
Okay, so right. The next number is going to be, there we go, 221, which should be on the ninth page.
221.
Man, that's some good looking food.
221 are some really gorgeous fingerless mitts by Ullad, Ullad. They're fingerless mitts in the colors of falling leaves. And they're a very pretty golden type color and gorgeous lace. So, Ullad, you need to PM Jessica and she will send you... Oh, she's from Denmark. She will have fun filling out the customs forms, Jess. She will PM you. PM her and she'll send you your prize. Now that's totally like that karma is going to come back on me and every single prize that I have to mail is going to be overseas.
So let's do the next one is the pattern from Boston Jen. She did a really cool new one called View from the Charles and it's sort of multi-directional and it's got two different
It's asymmetrical kind of.
Yeah, and it's got like a lace section and a garter section. It's really cool. So we're going to give away one of those, and the winner of that one is number 468, which should be 16, 17, 18, 19th page, I think. 468. And this is, again, the pattern is called View from the Charles, and it's for fingering weight.
It's a really cool pattern. Mm-hmm. The winner of that is DQ Knits. And she's got a dishcloth that is super Halloween colors. Very pretty. All right. Do you want to give away your skin of yarn?
Yeah, it'll be my last thing. So, and this is from Ride of Color. And it is the Petunia's color of the Superwash Blue Face Luster. It's a bulky weight. And it is 183 yards. And so if you win this, PM me. You don't call me less and let me know with your address and I will get it out to you. This is for number 66, which should be the third page.
There's some really cool things in here.
I know, I've got to go through that thread. I haven't yet.
66. 66 is Cottontail. And she did, oh, that really cool pumpkin dishcloth that I want to do.
The one that's shaped like a pumpkin?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
That Nix did. So, very, very, and she did, like, a little, like, graphic with it. It's very, very cute. So, Cottontail, you need to PM Leslie, you don't call me Les, and she will get you your prize. Just let her know what it is, too.
Yeah, remind me what you won, because I'm not going to remember. So let's do next. What prize do you want to give away?
Let's do the bat from Joanna Spring. And then if you are not a spinner, I will spin this for you.
Aw, that's very nice. So we'll hit generate. And that's number 736, which 28, 29, 30, I think.
700 and what?
36.
Oh, it's Pam from NOLA.
Oh, cool.
And it's stuck out of doom therapy. And gloom and old blood-colored socks. I can't remember if she's a spinner or not. She is, because she's got hand spun in her stash.
Mm-hmm.
So, Pam, send me a PM, and I will mail this to you. I think those are Desert Vista socks. They are really pretty. Now I have to go look.
I know, I'm getting distracted by all the stuff in this thread.
It's Desert Vistas and the Color Accents wine colorway. It's a really pretty colorway. All right, so Pam from NOLA has won that. The second prize that I have is from Pecora Yarns. It is the Fall Maple colorway.
Oh, that I love so much.
It's really pretty, and that's from Christy.
My Wi-Fi thing is like, oh, you need to join the network, because I've never joined the network here. 444, which should be on 16, 17, 18th page.
444.
I like that yarn a lot.
It is really pretty. 444 is Sunny One. Signed one? Kathleen from Colorado, who is really, really sweet and posts a lot in our group. She posts in the question thread quite a bit. I actually almost picked her question today. So, Kathleen, if you will send me, and she did some log cabin dishcloths that are, I think, woven. Really, that's really cool. Pretty. Log cabins make her think of log cabin maple syrup, and on her recent trip to New England, where she passed many, many country stores selling maple syrup and cider donuts. Man, I miss cider donuts. So, Kathleen, if you will send me a PM, I will get this to you. And then the last prize we have is a Knitty Kitty bag.
That makes me laugh. I love the orange zipper, or the green zipper on that.
Yes. It matches the green eyes of the cat.
And that one's going to go to number 535, which should be the 22nd page.
La, 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 la. 535.
535,
that is, yeah. Pokey DJ, which is, from Vancouver, British Columbia. I knew I was going to get one. And she posted some gorgeous socks to keep her feet warm in cool fall weather.
Sweet. So well, now you really have a project bag to put your next project in.
Definitely. So thank you, everyone, for participating in the Halloween Craft All the Things. It's always so much fun. It's one of my favorite knit-alongs that we do. And just seeing the pictures that people post is so much fun.
I can see this is going to add to my queue. I've already gotten two things I need to add. Okay, I should probably not. All right.
We have one more prize to give away, which is two more prizes, because we were giving away in the group. There was a thread open for Ancient Arts yarn, and I'm going to go ahead and lock that thread right now. I have, we talked about Ancient Arts last week and how they do a lot of charity giveaways for cats and dogs.
Yeah, they dye colors specifically to help fundraise rescue organizations for both cats and dogs.
Strain abandoned cats, and this is one of the Meow Collection ones. It is La Chat Noir. And so we have, let me flip back out, we have between 2 and 305.
305. Done. Okay, so I haven't pushed the button yet. I'm going to push the button. The winner is number 78.
That's what I'm
for? Fourth page.
Aw, someone, there's a lot of cat pictures.
Aw.
So this one goes to TS Knits. It says, so many great colors to choose, but my eye immediately went to Inspired. So Tara from San Bruno, California, send me Lala a PM. If you won any of the prizes today, if you guys would include what you won, that would be amazing.
Because we do not enjoy going back and watching ourselves.
We are not rewatchers for the most part, so hopefully.
And then I have this to give away. This is a DK 100% superwash wool, and this is in the All the Secret Places colorway, which is a beautiful speckled blue and purple blend with got some really rich purples in there. And that one's going to go to number 144, which should be on the sixth page. And thank you, Ancient Arts, for the giveaway. They have several colors. I really want that cross-stitch sampler colorway. I'm going to have to break down and buy it.
Is it 144?
144, yes. I had to double check, yes.
That goes to 1267 needles for Grand Canyon and Sportweight MCN.
Okay.
There's a person on page 7 that's got Go Dog Go.
You're turning into like a zombie slow speaker at the moment.
I love Go Dog Go. Like the book.
I don't know that I've ever read that.
Aw. Yeah, there's a problem with the internet.
Yeah, it's probably my son downloading some terrible, awful game or something. I don't know. I usually tell him I didn't today. So I'm going to take the blame for that. So anyhow, aside from that, we just want to, we're very lucky. We have lots of great folks who send us yarn and books and tools and patterns and all of that so that we can get the word out to you guys. So we appreciate that very much. And we appreciate those who have chosen to support us on Patreon. If you haven't heard, we have started a Patreon account, which you can access through the Knit Girls website. There's in the top right corner, there's a link for support us through Patreon. You can choose to donate anywhere from $1 up per episode. It is a per episode thing, the way that it's set up. But if you don't or can't donate, that's no problem. Nothing's going to change for you. So
if you would rather just donate a flat amount, yeah. And if you would like to donate just a flat amount, we still have the PayPal button, allows you to do that as well.
So
I think that's about it.
Yeah, I think we should go before my connection gets any worse.
Pretty much a wrap.
Yeah. Okay. This is super fun and awkward. So
thank
y'all say goodbye.
So much.
Y'all have a wonderful week, and we'll see you again next weekend. Bye, y'all.
Bye, y'all.